Hi there, I'm Sandy Allnock, and today I'll be coloring some animals in Copic markers, and I'll show you a MISTI trick at the end of this video. This is a stamp set from the Colorado Craft Company, and it's a grad theme, but there are some sentiments in there that's just, you know, your awesome, good job kinds of sentiments, so you can use this stamp set all year long. I love it when stamp sets are that way. The image itself is all one picture, so no masking required, and I've stamped it on some Neenah cardstock using no-line ink from Ink on 3, which allows me to adapt the stamps as desired because I don't have those hard black lines forcing me into, you know, an arm has to be here, fingers have to be there, etc. I'm keeping the coloring really loose on this one. And I just kind of felt like it because I was going to make it a big party card, and making it loose made it actually feel more energetic as opposed to trying to create, you know, every single little hair. I had debated whether this would be a video where I'd add pencil on top because you can add pencil details and that can help your blending sometimes. If you have an area that the Copic couldn't do it for you, sometimes you can do that better in pencil. But then I realized when I was done with this, it looked like the animals were moving because it was soft, and I left it that way. The colors for each one of the animals individually are over on my blog. I stopped in between each one and took a photograph of the markers that go with that animal. So if you're looking for what those specific colors are, then you can check that out in the link in the doobly-doo. And for the kitty here, I pulled up a picture of a tabby. And there are tabbies that are more gray-based, and there's tabbies that are more yellow. And this is one that was more yellow, so I put some yellow down first. I can always tone that down by going over it with some grays like I'm doing, but the yellow gives it that flavor of being that particular kind of tabby cat. There's some that have more regular brown in them rather than this golden hue. So it really depends on what kind of kitty you're trying to color. I also Googled pictures of the name of the animal with the word standing. So hopefully I could see what their belly looks like because I wanted to see which ones had color on their tummies and which ones don't. You know, who has a pure white belly and who has some gray in there, that sort of thing. And looking for images like that. So this little mouse, the picture that I found had just color on the head and the arms. And then the whole belly was completely white, which meant that I was going to adapt the animal that's behind it because I needed to put some color around the mouse in order for him to show up because otherwise it's just white next to white paper. So I decided to make an Australian Shepherd. And a friend of mine has Australian Shepherds and I went to her Instagram page and looked through because she had pictures of her Australian Shepherds jumping in the air and stuff so I could see their bellies and their markings, that kind of thing. So if you know somebody who has the animal you're looking for, go see if you can replicate theirs and the markings that are on them. So I left the belly white because hers have white bellies. And I had sketched everything in a lighter gray first because then I can kind of be sure where I want those markings to be and change my mind if I need to using some other colors to lighten them. You could go over some of that with a lighter gray, soften some of those. But then once I was sure that's where I was headed, then I went in with some darker colors, including a reddish brown kind of color in order to give it that Australian Shepherd look that her dogs have. And then I needed to start working into some of the gray areas and defining some of the shapes. When there's a white on white shape, like around the bottom of the chin, you have to put some gray underneath of it so that you define that space. Otherwise, it just turns into kind of a big old blob, if you know what I mean. And we don't want blobs. And on this dog, since there's black around the eyes or, you know, really dark color around the eyes, I had to switch to using white for the pen for the eyes when I was drawing them back in. The other ones, I alternated between using a 0.005 Micron pen, which is really, really tiny and can get these tiny eyes in there. Or you can use, I have a 0.3, I think is my smallest in my Copic multiliner. So I always keep a bunch of different pens handy when I'm going to put in little details like this. And I'm just putting in the eyes and the nose and smiles on them. Make sure you have them smiling because they're partying. They're having a big yay moment. Now, this little hamster guy, I'm assuming it's a hamster. I can only imagine that it would be. There was one picture that I saw that had this kind of really orangey flavor to it. It was really bright. And I was trying to mimic that. And I realized it was just a little too much. So I ended up, you know, having this as the undercoat. But then when I got everything settled the way I wanted it, I added some grays, a little darker gray in the shadow areas, and then lighter gray to blend it, which brought everything back to being a more neutral, natural looking color for the whole picture. So it all kind of went together. If you have one animal that's like garishly crazy bright, even if that's realistic, if that's what the color really is, sometimes you need to pull it back to what's going on in the entire picture itself. Then it's time for the bunny. The mouse down below, by the way, is the same colors as the other mouse. And I'm skipping over then to the bunny, which was a brown bunny. I usually do different kinds of bunnies, but this one I wanted it to be brown. And I struggled a little bit here. There was a golden undertone, so I put the yellow down first and then started adding in my browns, trying really to be tentative about getting too dark too quickly because I don't always know how dark I'm going to be eventually. I might end up with a lighter brown, might end up with a darker, but you can see I just keep adding little tiny bits of darker color, which tends to slowly build up that dark until I'm comfortable with it. So if you're someone who's typically afraid of dark colors, just work in slowly and keep adding until you're satisfied with it. I'm gauging everything against that really dark dog because the dog sets the pace for everything else. When the dog is the only thing that has contrast, everything else looks wussy by comparison. So I wanted to have enough color there. And then I went for the grass, which is green down here. I had to do a couple layers because my green marker needs a little bit of re-inking. And the shadows that I'm putting under them, when they have 1 foot up in the air, the foot up in the air should not touch the shadow. When they're jumping with one foot touching the ground, the touching the ground foot should be the one that touches that shadow. And then it makes it look like their other foot is up in the air. Of course, when you start doing some blending and generalizing that color out, it does touch that higher foot, but the main shadow should be right under the foot that's touching the ground. Next, I wanted them to really party, so I did a bunch of green confetti, and I did large confetti as if this was leaves falling from the sky, because I thought that might be kind of fun, because they wouldn't have real confetti, because they're animals, and just added a little tiny bit of a shadow under some of them, not all of them, but really easy flick marks. And then I used that Micron pen because it's, again, that 005, super thin, and could add the whiskers. You could also do that with a really sharp pencil, just a regular number 2 pencil, and get something that approximates whiskers nicely. So now for the MISTI tip. I wanted just that dog peeking in the corner on the inside panel, and I wanted to remove the cat that's there. And you could do this with any of the animals. Just do this, just place the animal where you want them on the piece of paper and stamp it onto some masking paper. And this is Eclipse Tape by Judykins. So I've got it stamped down here and I'm not going to remove it from where it's stuck down. What I need to do is grab my scissors, just some little detail scissors, and I want to cut out that animal because I need to make a hole where the animal is. There's one place where there's a little paw from one animal and some little eyeball, or not eyeballs, ears from the other animal down below. And I need to cut around those so that those stay masked out and then cut around that ear so that the ear shows up when I do my stamping and the cat on the left disappears. This was probably a little complex for just doing this dog in the corner because you can probably do that a little bit easier. But I figured it would show you how to do this. If you wanted to take one of the other animals and put just that one on your card, you could do it with this very same way. Just cut out the animal itself so that you only get that little piece in the corner. So this has my little puppy there with the I'm proud of you sentiment on the inside of the card, which was kind of a fun way to do something like this instead of putting the sentiment on that busy card front. So that is it for me. You can go see the color numbers and stuff over on my blog if you want, and pin that post so you can return to it once you get your stamp set and you want to try to color them like the way I did. That's it for me. I will see you again very soon. Take care and have an awesome day.